Assalamualaikum. So I hope all of you are okay. We were studying pituitary gland and we studied antidiuretic hormone. Our next topic is oxytocin. So let's start oxytocin. Oxytocin is another endocrine hormone that is released by the posterior pituitary gland. That is the neurohypophysis. So, as I told you earlier, the major part of the ADH, antidiuretic hormone, was secreted by supraoptic nucleus. On the other hand, most of the oxytocin is secreted by the paraventricular nucleus of the hypothalamus, and some minor quantities also secreted by produced by the supraoptic nucleus. It is also peptide in nature, and it is a nano peptide, same as that of ADH. So it is produced here in the paraventricular cells, and the supraoptic nucleus travel down through the hypothalamic hypophyseal tract into the posterior pituitary, stored there and then released. Now let's look at some functions of oxytocin. So what functions does it serve? The main functions are on pregnant uterus and in milk ejection. So what it does in a pregnant female individual who is about to deliver the baby towards the end of the gestation period. Gestation period is about 40 weeks long. So the developmental period within the uterus is known as the gestation period. Towards the end of the gestation, it causes the contraction of the fundus and the body of the uterus, that is this upper part. So the fundus and the body, it contracts so as to push the baby forward towards the cervix and out of the birth canal, that is vagina. Moreover, it causes relaxation of cervix of the uterus, which leads to the childbirth. So what happens is this part of the uterus contracts, pushes the baby forward, this part relaxes so as to promote the downward movement of the baby outside the uterus and into the birth canal, that is the vagina. This action of oxytocin is controlled by positive feedback, that is, the more the contractions, the more the oxytocin would be released. Whereas in non-pregnant uterus, in a female who has not conceived yet, this oxytocin causes contraction of uterus during coitus, that is during the sexual intercourse, and helps to transport spermatozoa upwards towards the fallopian tube. So during sexual intercourse, oxytocin is released and it would cause contraction of the uterus. Oxytocin is also known as the sex hormone or the happy hormone, because it is mostly released during the sexual gratification of the females. It also has effect on milk ejection. So what happens is in lactating females, that is the females who are feeding their baby their milk, whenever the baby suckles the breast, the areola of the breast, this would have a positive feedback and release oxytocin from the posterior pituitary, which would in turn help to expel the accumulated milk which is present within the breast tissues follicles by the contraction of myoepithelial cells, that are the muscular cells which would contract and push the milk out of the breast. action of oxytocin on the pregnant uterus, I've already told you this thing. What happens is when the head of the fetus pushes against the cervix, a nerve impulse is generated, that is neuronal signals carried by nerves from the cervix towards the brain. This would in turn stimulate the brain, the posterior pituitary gland, to secrete oxytocin. This oxytocin is carried in the bloodstream towards the uterus, and this would stimulate the uterus when it reaches it, and promote uterine contractions and promote cervical relaxation that would push the fetus towards the cervix and out of the uterus. Okay, so now let's talk about how does milk ejection work. So what happens is this milk ejection is a neurohormonal reflex mechanism by which milk is released from the breast. So there are some hormones involved and there is the involvement of the brain. So what happens is when the baby suckles the nipple or touches the breast of his or her mother, or on the crying of the baby and even thinking about the baby, oxytocin is released. So on thinking about the baby, crying of the baby, and the most strong stimulus is the suckling of the nipple or touching of the breast by the baby, oxytocin is released, and in turn milk is released from the breast. So sometimes even without suckling of the baby, milk keeps releasing from the breast, and it causes a problem for a new mother. That is because of if the baby is crying due to hunger, it would automatically stimulate the oxytocin in the posterior pituitary and automatically start secretion of the milk. So the suckling of the nipple of the breast would transmit signals, nerve impulses via sensory nerves towards the brainstem. In the brainstem, mainly the supraoptic nucleus and to some extent the paraventricular nucleus of the hypothalamus would release oxytocin. This oxytocin would be carried to the posterior pituitary via the hypothalamic hypophyseal tracts, which would then release this oxytocin into the blood. This oxytocin then would reach via blood to the breast tissue and would cause contraction of the myoepithelial cells which surround the lobules which are producing the milk, and it would in the end cause ejection of milk from the alveoli to the ducts and outside the breast. Again, all of this is explained in this picture. So what happens is when the baby suckles the nipple of the mother, an afferent nerve impulse would travel from the nipple towards the hypothalamus. Now in hypothalamus, oxytocin would be produced. It would migrate along the nerve fibers. This would be carried towards the brainstem and from the brainstem towards the hypothalamus. This can also be done due to psychogenic stimulus, that is the crying of the baby or the sight of the baby or thinking about the baby or just baby touching the breast, and paraventricular nucleus of the hypothalamus would start producing oxytocin. Remember a mnemonic, that is POSA, P-O-S-A, POSA. POSA means paraventricular for oxytocin and supraoptic for ADH. So POSA, remember this, P-O-S-A. Paraventricular oxytocin, supraoptic ADH. So this would be produced, travels downwards through the hypothalamic hypophyseal tract, reach the posterior pituitary, and then released. Moreover, there is another thing that is at work here, that is the release of prolactin from the anterior pituitary. The stimuli are the same. due to these stimuli, prolactin would be released from the anterior pituitary, which would cause the milk production. So remember this, prolactin causes production of milk. Lactin or lactose means milk. It is a sugar that is present in the milk. So lactin or lactose would always mean milk. Prolactin, promoting the lactin. So promoting the production of the milk. This hormone promotes the production of the milk. Whereas oxytocin would cause release of the milk. Okay. Moreover, this oxytocin also causes uterine contraction in gravid or non-gravid uterus. In gravid uterus towards the end of the gravid period, and in non-gravid uterus during coitus, during sexual intercourse. Now we've come to another important part of the endocrinology, that is the anterior pituitary gland. So we'll talk about different hormones, the mechanism of action and everything here. So let's start by starting the anterior pituitary gland. Anterior pituitary gland is also known as the adenohypophysis. Why is it known as adeno? Adeno stands for gland. And there are endocrine glands, basically cells here, which would produce different kind of endocrine hormones, which would then travel and perform different functions. Many of these are the trophic hormones, which would in turn cause release of different hormones, and many of these are end hormones that would go on to act on different organs of our body. So adenohypophysis is composed of five groups of cells which would go on to secrete different hormones. These cells are somatotrophs, corticotrophs, thyrotrophs, gonadotrophs and lactotrophs. All of these cells would be controlled by the hypothalamus via growth hormone releasing hormone, a cortical releasing hormone or CRH, thyrotrophin releasing hormone or TRH, gonadotropin releasing hormone or GnRH, and lactotroph. Lactotroph produces prolactin. There is no releasing hormone for prolactin, but the hypothalamus produces a substance that is dopamine that would inhibit the release of prolactin. So for all of the above four cells, there is positive feedback, that is production of trophic hormones that would in turn cause release of these hormones. Whereas in lactotrophs, for the release of prolactin, it has negative feedback, that is production of dopamine. Dopamine production by the hypothalamus would inhibit lactotrophs, would stop the release of prolactin. So the first cells that are present in anterior pituitary gland are known as somatotrophs. Somato is related with growth. So somatotrophs release human growth hormone or GH. Okay. Then there are corticotrophs. Corticotrophs would release adrenocorticotropin or adrenocorticotropic hormone. The precursor to this hormone is the CRH, whose full name is pro-opiomelanocortin. It would stimulate melanin stimulating hormone or melanin. It would produce, it would divide into melanin stimulating hormone and CRH. CRH would in turn cause production of ACTH, whereas MSH would cause production of melanin. Moreover, it also produces some endorphins, beta endorphins to be exact. Endorphins are those hormones which make us feel good in our head. So beta endorphins are happy hormones kind of. Thyrotrophs are stimulated by TRH, or thyroid releasing hormone, which is which stimulates these thyrotrophs, and it releases the TSH, that is thyroid stimulating hormone, and it goes on to act on the thyroid gland. gonadotropins are controlled by GnRH, that is gonadotropin releasing hormone, and the hormone secreted from anterior pituitary in result of gonadotropin releasing hormone from hypothalamus are the luteinizing hormone and the follicle stimulating hormone, which would go on to act on the testes and the ovaries. In the end, there are lactotrophs which have negative feedback. They are controlled by hypothalamus by release of dopamine, which inhibits the production of prolactin from the lactotrophs. And these lactotrophs would produce prolactin that would promote production of milk in females. So this is the hypothalamus, anterior and posterior pituitary. You can see different types of cells, tissues here, which are divided across different lobes. Okay, so we were talking about the pituitary secretions. So I've told you what are the glands that are located in the anterior pituitary. What are different types of cells which are located in the anterior pituitary. Now we are going to talk about the secretions by the anterior pituitary. So the secretions, all of the secretions, all of the hormones that are produced by the anterior pituitary are in turn controlled by the hypothalamus. That is the center or the main brain behind all of the hormones, endocrine hormones. So secretions by the anterior pituitary is controlled by hormones which are known as hypothalamic releasing hormones and hypothalamic inhibitory hormones or factors. So there are some hormones which would promote the release of different hormones from anterior pituitary, and then there are some hormones which would inhibit the release. As I told you earlier, the release of oxytocin is limited, is inhibited by dopamine release. So these factors are secreted within the hypothalamus and then conducted to the anterior pituitary through minute blood vessels which are known as hypothalamic hypophyseal portal vessels. So pituitary hormones produced would be transported. Sorry, hypothalamic hormones produced would be transported to the pituitary gland through these special channels or ducts which are located within the pituitary stalk or hypophyseal stalk. Okay, so here we can see the hypothalamus, and there are different stimulating as well as inhibiting factors which are produced here in the hypothalamus, and then these are transported towards the anterior pituitary gland via the special network of hypothalamic hypophyseal portal vessels. So let's talk about the hormones that are released from the hypothalamus and what hormones they initiate or inhibit in pituitary gland. The thyrotropin releasing hormone is released from the hypothalamus, which would in turn stimulate the thyrotrophs which are present in the pituitary and promote the secretion of thyroid stimulating hormone, which would then go on to act on the thyroid gland. Then there is the gonadotropin releasing hormone, which would promote the production of follicle stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone from the anterior pituitary, and these would go on to act on gonads. Then there is the corticotropin releasing hormone, which transforms into propiomelanocortin, as I've told you earlier, and this would go on to release ACTH, that is adrenocorticotropic hormone, from the corticotrophs of pituitary. Gonadotropin releasing hormone would act on gonadotrophs. Growth hormone releasing hormone would act on somatotrophs and would in turn stimulate the secretion of growth hormone from the pituitary gland. The growth hormone, then there is one hormone that is known as somatostatin or growth hormone inhibitory hormone, which would inhibit the release of growth hormone from the somatotrophs. There is another hormone that is known as prolactin inhibiting hormone, PIH, that would inhibit the secretion of prolactin from the pituitary gland. Now let's look at some functions of anterior pituitary hormones. So the functions they primarily perform are: the growth hormone causes growth of almost all of the cells and tissues of the body. The adrenocorticotropin or ACTH would cause adrenal cortex to secrete adrenocortical hormones. The thyroid stimulating hormone would cause thyroid gland to secrete thyroxine and triiodothyronine. And follicle stimulating hormone would cause growth of follicles in the ovaries and ovulation and sperms and testes. These things we've studied again and again in the earlier slides, so I'm just going to go through these. The luteinizing follicle stimulating hormone would cause growth of follicles in ovaries prior to ovulation, and it would promote the formation of sperms and testes. The luteinizing hormone would play role in causing ovulation, and it also causes secretion of female sex hormones by ovaries and testosterone by testes. Prolactin would promote the development of breast and the secretion of milk in females. This is the complete range of anterior pituitary hormones, where they are secreted, what are their functions, etc. So anterior pituitary gland would release the thyrotropin, that is the thyroid stimulating hormone, which would act on thyroid gland to release the T3 and T4. The growth hormone would act on the body and increase the growth of all of the cells and the tissues. The ACTH would act on adrenal cortex, the corticotropin would act on the adrenal cortex and release acetylcholine, adrenocorticotropic hormone, which would increase blood glucose level. Follicle stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone would act on ovary and testes. Cortisol is released from the adrenal cortex that would promote the secretion of insulin and via acting on pancreas. Prolactin would act on mammary gland and produce milk. Now let's talk about all of these hormones one by one in detail. So the first hormone that we are going to study is the growth hormone. Growth hormone is a small hormone in structure. It is a small protein molecule and has 191 amino acids arranged in a special arrangement in it. It is also known as somatotropin or somatotrophic hormone, and its molecular weight is 22,005. Normal level of growth hormone in blood of an adult is 1.6 to 3 nanogram per ml, whereas in children it is 6 nanogram per ml, because children grow faster, they need faster mode of growth. That's why growth hormone is released in larger quantities in children as compared to adults. Let's talk about some functions of the growth hormone. It promotes the growth of many body tissues. In fact, it promotes the growth of all of the tissues of the body that are capable of growing. That would include the bones, the cartilage, the skin, all of the organs, etc. And it would also help in specific differentiation of different types of cells. Growth hormone stimulates the cartilage and bone growth, which would result in increased deposition of protein by the chondrocytic and osteogenic cells that would cause bone growth. So it would promote the action of chondroblasts as well as the osteoblasts. Blast cells are those which would deposit different chemicals within the bones and cartilage. This growth hormone would also increase the rate of reproduction of these cells, and it would also have a special effect of converting chondrocytes into osteogenic cells and thus causing deposition of new bone. So when we were studying the bone, I told you there is a cartilaginous growth model in which the cartilage, first cartilage is formed, then there are growth centers which are formed within the cartilage and mature bone grows on from there. So the growth hormone would promote the conversion of chondrocytes into osteocytes or osteoblasts. It also has many metabolic effects, that is, it promotes and increases the rate of protein synthesis in most cells of the body. This protein would be utilized, would be stored and help in growing the body. It would also cause increased mobilization of fatty acids from the adipose tissue, that is, more resorption of fat from the fatty tissue, more utilization and henceforth production of more energy. It would also increase fatty acids in the blood, and it would increase the use of fatty acids for energy. The growth hormone also has a role in carbohydrate metabolism, that is, it would decrease the rate of glucose utilization throughout the body and in turn increase the glucose deposition in the body. Thus, in effect, growth hormone would enhance the body protein, uses up the fat stores and conserves the glucose of the carbohydrates so as to produce an energy boost in the body so that the body can grow rapidly. Growth hormone exerts much of its effect through intermediate substances which are known as somatomedins. Somatomedins are also known as insulin-like growth factors. Why are they known as insulin-like growth factors? Because all of the functions of these somatomedins are similar to that of the insulin. Insulin promotes uptake of glucose, so it conserves the glucose. Insulin would increase the rate of protein synthesis and deposition of proteins within the cells, and the somatomedins perform the same function. That is why they are also known as insulin-like growth factors. So growth hormone, when it is transported to the liver via blood, it is converted into IGF-1, that is insulin-like growth factor 1, or somatomedin C. This somatomedin C would go on to act in on different tissues of the body throughout the body. So if we want to check the level of growth hormone, there are many times when we check the concentration of IGF-1 in the body. So the diagnostic test for the production of growth hormone is IGF-1 testing, because growth hormone is only released when we sleep at night and it is more prevalent then, and its level keeps fluctuating throughout the day. But somatomedin C or IGF-1 has kind of a constant level. So that is how growth hormone is directed within the body. Growth hormone is secreted in a pulsatile pattern In the body, it keeps on increasing and decreasing throughout the day, throughout life. And there are several factors which are related to a person's state of nutrition or stress that are known to stimulate the secretion of growth hormone or inhibit the secretion of growth hormone. So now we'll talk about some factors that stimulate or inhibit the secretion of growth hormone. So decreased blood glucose level, decreased blood free fatty acids would promote the release of growth hormone, whereas increased blood glucose or increased blood free fatty acids would decrease, inhibit the production of growth hormone. Starvation or fasting and protein deficiency would also release growth hormone, promote the release of growth hormone. Moreover, trauma, stress, excitement, exercise, testosterone, estrogen, deep sleep in stages 2 and 4 of the sleep would promote the release of growth hormone. So would the growth hormone releasing hormone that is released from the hypothalamus. Whereas aging, obesity, growth hormone, inhibitory hormone that is somatostatin and growth hormone would have negative feedback and would inhibit the release of growth hormone from the anterior pituitary. So what happens is when the growth hormone is released to its normal quantity, the quantity of no growth hormone becomes normal or more than normal in blood, it would in turn inhibit the release of more growth hormone from the anterior pituitary. Moreover, somatomedins, that is the insulin-like growth factors, when they increase in number in the blood, they would also inhibit more secretion of growth hormone. So hypoglycemia, exercise, trauma, and stress would affect the hypothalamus, which would in turn release the growth hormone releasing hormone, which would act on anterior pituitary and release the growth hormone. It goes on into the liver and is converted into somatomedins that would act on the tissues. Now what happens is when the somatomedin becomes enough in blood, that is the body detects that we do not need any more somatomedin. It has negative feedback on the anterior pituitary and it stops producing more growth hormone. Okay, so we conclude our lecture on this. We'll study the applied physiology of the growth hormone in the next lecture, inshallah. Thank you. And God bless.